So let's focus on increasing the intensity and outward push of this impact. So we're going to introduce not only some screen distortion for this piece, but we want to have some like nice pop and flash, right? And this is going to be the first part to help sell that. We're also going to learn something new that I haven't ever covered in any other tutorials that I've done, and that's talking about the dynamic parameter. And it's pretty simple. It's just like an extrovert color expression like we use in our materials, but it has some, neat options that we can do as well. So let's go ahead and get started by creating a new material in our package here. So go to our materials group, right click, do new material. For name, we'll just call it, what do we want to call it? FX distortion sphere underscore matte. And let's go ahead and bring it over first. Let's change everything to our blend mode to additive. And let's do our lighting mode, or lighting model, I should say, to unlit. And then let's go ahead and bring in our normal map noise from our textures group. So with that selected, go ahead and hold down T and bring it in. And then take the red channel and plug that straight into distortion. Now we can start to see it's distorting the background a little bit. It's not really selling that impactfulness, and it doesn't have the kind of streaky elements that I like that we did in the distortion on the shockwave itself. So let's do the same kind of techniques here by bringing in a panner and plugging in that panner into the UVs of the texture sample. And let's pan it, I think, -4 on Y. So now we start to see a little bit of motion happening here. It doesn't have that streakiness to it, so let's go ahead and bring in a texture coordinate. Plug that into the coordinate of our panner. And I want to tile U, let's see, 10 times, and I want to stretch V to 0.3. So now you can see we've got a really cool, streaky, shockwavy kind of distortion to it, and it's really evident here where you see the kind of thick line where I'm putting my mouse back and forth. So before we go any further with this material, let's just go ahead and compile this. Let's get this going inside of Cascade and start to see what we like and what we don't like and how we can improve on it. So let's just go ahead and compile it. In this case, like we said before, this emitter is going to be using a mesh as well, and it's just a simple sphere. So I've got that. If you want to make your own, that's fine. But I've included one in the source art directory. So let's go to source art, meshes, and then find FX sphere underscore static mesh. Just make sure it's going into the meshes group and then hit OK. And then find our material here. Let's find our distortion sphere material. Hit Control C to copy that path. Go into the static mesh editor and just paste that into our material channel here. Now, if you don't see anything happening, that's totally expected. That's because there's nothing really to distort. It's just a solid gray background. So it's working. It's just kind of invisible to our eyes. So that's all said and done. Let's go ahead into our particle system and create a new emitter. So right-click, new particle sprite emitter. We'll do our standard housekeeping stuff. Let's change this name to distortion sphere. Let's do emitter loops to 1. Did I just totally pass it up? That's right in front of me. There we go. Emitter loops to 1. Let's go ahead and delete initial velocity. And then let's add a mesh data module so we can point to our sphere. So we'll go right click, type data, and mesh data. So we need to go in the mesh data module and we need to point to our mesh. So let's find that in our meshes group. With that selected, we can go ahead and click on the green arrow to point the mesh. Now we don't see anything, and that's because our size is huge right now. We can see lots of nasty distortion happening here as well because we have so many of these meshes. Let's go ahead and fix all that stuff one at a time. Let's fix the size first. Let's do init size, change it to constant distribution, and then do locked axes to XYZ. Remember, what all this does is just, it's like a convenient shortcut. If you set it to locked axes X, Y, and Z, anything you put in X gets propagated automatically to both Y and Z. So since we're scaling this uniformly, it just keeps it a little more simple. And then let's go ahead and do a size by life on this. So just like before, with the shockwave, we want this to grow by just increasing its size. So we're going to go size by life, and take those 2 points by default, and they're perfectly timed. All we need to do is just change the first point size to 0, 0, 0 in X, Y, and Z. So now we can see those spheres growing. So let's go ahead then and fix the lifetime and how many we're spawning as well. So we're spawning too many. We just want one of these because, you know, it only takes one to do screen distortion. And screen distortion is honestly a performance hit, so you don't want to keep emitting meshes because those meshes will compound when it comes to GPU performance. So rate will change our spawn rate to zero, and then we'll go ahead and burst by adding a point at time zero and just tell it to burst one sphere. So looking pretty good. The timing is way off though. We need this to match a lot better with our shockwave. So our lifetime of our shockwave is 0.3. In this case, I want it to be just slightly shorter. So let's go ahead and change this to constant and do 0.28. So it's just gonna die a little quicker than the other one. So, and then we wanna do something, a cool little neat trick that I haven't talked about, and that's with mesh alignment. So we talked about this in the Cascade Beginner's Guide about you can actually have meshes be like camera aligned and so forth. But we didn't really ever do a practical example of that. So let's go ahead and do that. And to do it, you know, we go in the same area where we do our regular screen alignment, but we have this extra option down here called type specific. So by checking it to type specific, what it's going to do is going to allow our mesh data module to dictate our orientation and our camera facing options. So down here in camera facing, all I want to do is check the camera facing box, and I want to do velocity align Z facing. So what's happening here, I'm gonna slow it down really slowly. At 10% speed, we can see that no matter where I rotate, those distortion streaks are always pointing towards us. And what it is that the poles of the sphere, right, the tops and the bottoms, are actually always facing towards us. And we can really see that if we go into wireframe mode, and then let's go ahead and solo our distortion sphere, and then pause it. We can see here as I rotate around, the pole here is always facing towards us. That's pretty neat in giving the effect always the same sense of directionality, no matter where the camera is facing. So let's go ahead and go back into our regular mode here. Go back into unlit. So looking pretty good. Let's just go ahead now and take a look at it in the game. You know, needs intensity first and foremost. Let's turn on our shockwave back as well. We can see that it really is lacking intensity. It's a kind of subtle thing right now. And in this case, I really want it to, like, you know, distort the background and to help convey that energy. The other thing that we're noticing too, if we put it in slow-mo, we can see that the screen distortion just stops immediately as soon as the particle dies, right? We have no really easy way of controlling distortion until we introduce something called a dynamic parameter. And we could do this with a vert color node as well. You could, like, hijack the alpha channel just like we did in the Sparks tutorial. But in this case, we're going to learn the dynamic parameter, and we're going to use that one of those channels to be able to animate the distortion. So instead of this distortion just popping off, I actually want the amount of distortion to fade down. We can also really boost it like we said as well. So to do that, we need to go inside of our material here. And we need to add a dynamic parameter. And, you know, really key, this is exactly like the vert expression, or the vert color expression, excuse me. We have two of these, as you can see here, and there's one for regular particles and one for mesh particles. And remember, this is a mesh sphere that we're emitting, so you have to use the right one, otherwise you're gonna be really, really frustrated, right, as you're trying to enter these values and nothing's being changed. So just be aware of that. So we can look at it, and this looks very, very similar to a mesh emit vert color node. So let's actually bring one in so we can kind of compare what the differences are. And it still has, you know, our four outputs, red, green, blue, and alpha. It doesn't have a combined one, so we don't have a red, green, blue combined. But what we notice here too is that we actually have parameter names that we can enter in just for organization. You don't have to touch these, you know, you can leave them as param 1, 2, and 3, and 4. I think the only rule is that they can't have same names, otherwise it's gonna freak out. So in this case, I'm gonna use the blue channel, and I'm gonna name this distortion control underscore, or we'll just do param like that. Now, if you're asking, hey, why did you use the blue one instead? Why didn't you start with red? You can use whatever you want. This is just simply because of the way I organized it when I first made the material and then did the notes for this tutorial. I just kind of worked backwards. So I just wanted to keep everything organized. It was easier on my end. So don't think you have to use blue for distortion or anything like that. You can use any color that you want. Let's take that blue now and let's multiply it against the texture sample that's going into our distortion. So I'm going to make a little bit of room just so we have some space here. We're not so crowded. So let's take that red channel that's panning, bring it into our multiply, take the blue from our mesh emit dynamic parameter, and then take that multiply result and plug it into distortion. So inside the material here, we're not going to really see any difference, right? Because it works just like our mesh emit vert color node, in that the default value inside the material editor is always just one. So one times anything always yields the exact same result as it came in. So that's expected. But if we go inside of Cascade now, we can go ahead and compile the material. Bring our emitter up. No, that is our material. There we go. And let's go ahead and add by going to right-click, parameter, and then dynamic. So with this module here now, it's kind of like a color over life module, but it has some different options. But most importantly, if we close all of these up, we can see that we have 0, 1, 2, and 3. And those are the exact same thing that we control with 0, 1, 2, and 3 here. So we know that blue is 0, 1, 2, so we want to adjust everything in blue. And 2, excuse me, to adjust blue. So what we can see here now, if we go into number 2, we can go to parameter value down here, and the default is 0, right? So we can see that our distortion is totally turned off because anything times 0 is 0. So if we set it back to 1, our distortion kicks back in. If we set it back to 100, we can see the distortion is gone, you know, cuckoo bananas, right? We can maybe do something a little more reasonable, like 20, let's say. But now we're really boosting that the amount of distortion. So what we can do now is animate this over time, right? So that it's really, really heavy distortion in the beginning and then it fades out over the particle's lifetime. So let's do, for our distribution, let's do constant curve. Let's add a point, leave that at time 0. And we're gonna really boost it, although we're gonna do some other things that's make it a little more subdued later on. But at time 0, I actually wanna set this to 100 times the regular amount of distortion. And then we're going to add another point here at time 1 and set that down to 0. So we can see that it starts to fade out, and it still happens really fast, right? But when we do some things here with Fresnel that I'm going to show you, it's going to make a little more sense. And the other thing that we notice too now, and it goes back to my personal hatred for this, is that we see that we still have like a really hard edge in the distortion itself, right? So that's a style that I just personally don't like. If you think it's okay, you know, that's totally fine. But I want to knock that out inside the material with a Fresnel or a dot product. So just like we do our dot product for opacity or additive materials into emissive, we can do the same thing and basically knock out the distortion so that the fringes don't distort. So it gives us a much more softer feel. So let's go ahead, do our standard dot product setup. So we'll do dot product. We'll bring in a camera vector. And then hold down the letter, or I'm sorry, the number 3 and click. And then change blue to 1. And put that into our dot product. Now, I also want to do something to where I get a little more of a softer edge by bringing in an exponent or a power expression. And to kind of illustrate what's happening here, I'm going to plug this into emissive. So I'm going to disconnect distortion temporarily and plug our dot product into emissive so you can understand what this does. So you can see our standard dot product does, you know, what we've become accustomed to, in that we've got softer edges as we get towards the fringes of the mesh, right? If I want to make that softness even greater, we can bring in an exponent, right, to help push that out. So let's do a power expression. And then hold down the number 1 to bring in a scalar value. So for the, and you have to put these in order. So the dot product goes into the base, and this is going to be our exponent, our scalar value. So if we plug this now into emissive, we're going to see that it totally freaks out and turns solid white. So it's not really doing anything. But in this case, if we set it back to 1, we can see where it was before. But if we go in higher values, so let's say like to the power of 5, it's really softening up those edges as well. So that's what we're doing with this power here. I just wanted to be very clear on that. So we can go ahead and disconnect that. Let's bring in our distortion back. And then let's go ahead and multiply this Fresnel here that we've made. Let's make a little room. Let's multiply this Fresnel against our texture that's dictating how much distortion we have here. If I multiply those two together and now plug this into our multiply against our dynamic parameter so we can control how much of that, you can see now that the edges have turned really soft, right? We don't get that hard edge anymore. Let's go ahead and compile it and we can look at it inside of Cascade. And we're getting a much softer edge here that we, that I really like. We're going to even take that further with opacity here just in a second too. So what I want to do now is add like a piece of glow to this as well, because we said this in the beginning of the chapter. This is going to be the first indicator of the impact, right? Or the big flash that happens, right? And we sell impacts with some kind of energy like that, like a quick burst of light or energy or something like that. So let's take our existing dot product here. And let's actually just duplicate this power expression here. I just hit Control W, which is the shortcut to duplicate. Let's move this up here towards the top. And let's be super organized here. And let's go ahead and Control-Alt-Drag and move all this stuff down that's related to distortion. Right-click and do new comment and just name this the distortion group. And I'm purposefully leaving our dynamic parameter out of this because we're going to use it for other aspects. So I don't want you to think that this is only related to distortion. So we've got that organized. Let's take in that power now. Let's take our dot product, bring that into our base. And in this case, I actually want to be able to control the exponent value, that softness that we just talked about, through our dynamic parameter. So we can actually animate that over time inside of Cascade. So in this case, I'm going to use the red channel. And let's go ahead and name that properly as well. So we're going to take the red one, which is 0 on our list, and call this our Fresnel exponent param. And then what we're going to do is invert this. So let's actually look at it if we plug it into emissive. It looks pretty good. I want to actually invert it, which you're going to say, why would you want to do that? Because that goes exactly against what I've been saying of what I hate with these, right? Which we're going to see in a second. So I'm going to invert this power, plug that inverted value into emissive. So now we get, you know, a harder edge with a softer center. And you're gonna, and as I was saying before, why would I want to do this? Well, we're actually going to knock out opacity here just in a second with our other Fresnel. But what we're going to do here now is take this and plug it against our random panning noise here. So let's make a little room. Let's take our random panning noise and multiply our inverted Fresnel against the red channel. We'll plug that into emissive. And now we can see we get some streaks. And we'll go ahead and fix that in a second here, like I said, with the opacity for that hard edge. Now what we need to do is we want to be able to color tint this inside of Cascade. So take the mesh emit vert color node, multiply this, the red, green, and blue, against the multiply of our texture versus our Fresnel, and then plug that into emissive. So let's go ahead and compile this now. Let's take a look at it. We don't see any color. We want to be able to give this a little bit of boost too. So we're looking at it and we're wondering, why don't we see anything, even though we have the default color over life module here that comes with every emitter. And part of that is because, remember, in our dynamic parameter, we're now using the top one, 0, to control our exponent. So let's go into the constant here and change that to 1. And now we can start to see what's happening. And we're getting some of that color tinting that we want. So let's take our color over life. Let's do our first point. Let's change that to time 0.2, so 1/5 of the particle's lifetime. We want to be 0.833 repeating on red, 1.25 on green, and 2.5 on blue. And then for our second point, we'll leave that at time 1, and then we'll change that to 0, 0, 0. So basically, remember, it's additive, so it's just going to fade out. And we can look at our color over life here. We can graph it. We could also do a little bit of tangent smoothing as well. We can select our first point and then just hit curve auto so we get smoother tangents as well. Let's go to our dynamic parameter. We've got a default value of 1, but like I said, we want to actually be able to animate this over time. So I'm going to boost this like crazy and then change this. So what we're going to do is change it to constant curve to boost it like crazy and then add a point at time 0, and we're going to boost it to a value of 50, right? And then actually, I take that back. That first point, I don't want it at time 0. I want it at time 0.3. So roughly a third of the way into its life, it's got this really hot boost here. And then I want to take our second point here, and I want to put that at time 0.6. And I really want to soften it up, so I'm going to do 0.3. So you can see that Fresnel exponent, right, like shrinking really fast right there. It like almost shrinks down to the edges. So let's go back into the material really quick. And I want to do one last thing. Remember, I've been saying over and over, I hate this hard edge happening here. All I want to do is take this this power here that we're using from our distortion. Let's plug that into opacity. So now we're getting a much softer edge there. So let's go ahead and compile that. And now it looks pretty good. We can see that we get this cool like shrinking element here. Maybe 50 is too high. Let's go to our first point. Let's try, I don't know, 30. Yeah, that happens a little more smoothly. I like that. So it's all coming together, you know, pretty nicely, but it's lacking one last element, and that's still that flashy poppiness to it. So what we can do is use another one of these channels from our dynamic parameter and use that as just like kind of like a color boost, and we can animate that as well. So let's find our material here. Let's make a little bit of room. Let's kind of slide all this stuff back, and we'll leave our mesh emit vert color node kind of at the end here, because that's typically the thing we always leave at, you know, that's the mathematical operation that should always be happening last. Let's go ahead and slide all this stuff over, and let's go ahead and bring in an add. And let's add the result of all of these motion streaks that we just did and add it against the green, or the first channel from our dynamic parameter. So that result now goes into our multiply against our mesh emit vert color node. And now you can see we've got a boost, right? A big color boost that we can animate, and we can take away if we want inside of Cascade. So we'll name the parameter. We can name it, you know, Fresnel boost param. And then we can go ahead and compile that. And again, by default, we're not seeing anything because dynamic parameters always default to zero. But if we go into our parameter value here and let's set it to like 10 or something like that, now you can see we've got a really good boost with that blast. So we can go ahead and change it to constant curve to animate it. So we'll go constant curve, add a point at time 0.2. Let's try, I'm gonna say 6, that looks pretty good, maybe 7. And then at time, we're gonna add another point at time 0.5. We'll just leave that at 0. So that fade happens right at about halfway through the particle's lifetime, and we still see some of that distortion. So let's go ahead and play it at full speed so we can start to get a sense of this, and we can see how, you know, really fast and impactful this really starts to come across as. And we can look at our impact happening here, and boom, it's got a really nice piece of pop and flash to it. I think I'm just going to tweak one last thing. That last point we just added at 0.5, I think I want to pull it back actually back to 0.4 because it lingers just a little too much. Yeah, that looks a little better to me, to my eye. So that's it. We wrapped up this chapter. We're going to move on to our upward light rays, and that'll be the last mesh particles that we'll be emitting.